Hi, welcome to this webinar about QNX 7.0, hosted by Toradex and supported by our partners Triadem and QNX BlackBerry. Thank you very much for joining us today, and also thanks to our partners Triadem and QNX for contributing to this webinar. My name is Roman Schnarwieler, and I'm the CTO at Toradex. I'm joined by Gary Bleasdale, Regional Sales Manager at BlackBerry QNX, and Hans-Peter Vogel, co-founder of Triadem and responsible for the QNX BSP development. Triadem ported QNX to our products and is a main distributor of QNX. We started working with Triadem more than 10 years ago. This webinar will give you a quick overview about Toradex, followed by Gary, who talks about QNX in general, and Hans-Peter, who then goes into details, including showing how to build and debug a QNX image on Toradex products. At the end, we will have a question and answer session. Whenever you have questions throughout the webinar, please just type them into the chat window and we will address them at the end of the webinar. This webinar will be recorded and will be made available on our website in about 1 week from now. So let's start with a quick look at Toradex and our products. For those of you unfamiliar with Toradex and our products, we specialize in embedded computing solutions, particularly ARM-based system on modules or SOMs. We have two families of SOMs called Calibri and the Palace, within which the modules are pin compatible and interchangeable. Hardware and software development is done in-house, ensuring an optimized overall offering to our customers. We generally guarantee a 10 years plus product lifecycle, and we offer free technical support directly from our developers through our community and also through email. Sales are handled directly by Toradex. Our products can be ordered right from our website. And finally, we have offices around the world, allowing us to serve the needs of regional markets with local sales and technical support and local warehouses. Let's quickly have a look at our SOMs. As mentioned, we have two form factors, Apalis and Calibri. On the Apalis form factor, we have more the higher performance SoCs, starting at the dual core NXP added MX6 dual based product at 1 GHz, all the way up to a quad core Apalis TK1 based on the NVIDIA TK1 processor at 2.1 GHz. Apalis modules are ideal for high performance computing or graphics applications. It features all the high-speed interfaces available today, such as PCI Express, HDMI, USB, USB 3, of course, LVDS, but also CAN, I2C, SPI, and UART. We are currently in development of the Apalis i.MX8 module based on NXP's latest high-performance processor, i.MX8 Quad Max. It's an SoC with a dual-core Cortex-A72, quad-core Cortex-A53, a dual-core Cortex M4 for real-time processing. It will be the first Apalis module with integrated Wi-Fi and Bluetooth solution. On the other hand, we have the Calibri form factor. It is ideal for low to medium performance applications. It provides the standard interfaces such as UART, USB 2.0, I2C, SPI, parallel LCD, and so on. We start at the low frequency and low performance of around 400 MHz with our Calibri VF50, but also go up to higher performances with our Calibri T30, which uses a quad-core processor from NVIDIA, up to 1.4 GHz. Our latest addition on a Calibri form factor is the Calibri i.MX6 ULL. We have two different versions of this product, a low-end version, which is very power efficient, and a medium-level solution, which has more performance and also includes Wi-Fi and Bluetooth on the module. We will continue adding more products to both product families. During this demonstration, the demonstrations you will see in that webinar, we are using a Toradex Apalis i.MX6 quad-based system. Furthermore, I also would like to quickly mention another feature which we just recently introduced, Toradex Easy Installer. It's a tool which is pre-installed in our latest i.MX6-based module, and we will also roll this out to more of our products in the next month. This tool offers some very nice features. Once you boot one of our modules, a dialog pops up and lets you choose from various installation options. It directly fetches the information from our servers. We provide our latest images on our servers. In the near future, we will also add demo images such as the QNX demo and so on. If internet isn't directly available at the module, it's also possible to install images provided on a USB or SD memory card or through a local network. This brings me to the next very helpful feature. It helps automating and simplifying your production programming. You can prepare your software setup on, for example, an SD card and boot the module, and the Toradex Easy Installer automatically installs your software, including bootloader, image, file system, and so on, directly onto the module flash. But the Toradex Easy Installer also lets you recover corrupted modules. The tool can easily be loaded into a module's RAM and executed directly over USB. From there, you can again select the image and have it installed into the flash onboard. You can find more information about the Toradex Easy Installer and all our products on our website. So that was a very short introduction about Toradex and our system on module products. Don't hesitate to add questions to our products and offerings to the chat window, and we will answer them at the end of the webinar. Now, I would like to hand over to Gary with his introduction to QNX.
Okay, thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. My name is Gary Bleasdale. I'm the regional sales manager for QNX in Northern Europe, plus I also look after our distribution channel for EMEA. So I work closely with the distribution partners such as Triadem in Switzerland. For those of you who are not familiar with QNX, we've been around for almost 40 years. We were formed in around about 1980 by two very smart guys who took a look at Unix and decided they could make a fundamental change to the operating system architecture to create a new operating system which would be way more reliable. And Hans Peter will show you what they did in his section of the presentation shortly. So for the first 20 years of our existence, we really focused on the industrial and medical device market, where customers needed extreme reliability and potentially for systems that had to run 24/7. In around about the year 2000, we saw that vehicles were beginning to contain processing platforms that could make use of a 32-bit fully featured operating system. So we also added automotive as one of our focus markets. And to a lesser extent, we also work in the netcoms and security and defense markets. In around about the year 2010, we joined BlackBerry. And that was to allow BlackBerry to base its next generation of smartphone handsets on the QNX operating system. And today that's proving to be a real advantage because we're seeing more and more embedded customers are wanting to connect their devices to the internet to make use of the Internet of Things. So where their devices weren't previously connected and they had no real cybersecurity concerns, today they do have. And being able to bring BlackBerry's secure communications expertise to our embedded customers' projects is proving a real advantage today. So you're probably not aware, but you're surrounded by QNX all the time, but it's just in systems doing its job. And the kind of systems that you might find it in could be devices looking after the power grid, it could be in control and communication systems for trains, it could be in many, many cars, or in devices that look after TV broadcasts, or even devices that look after the Visa transaction network. And the common theme is that all of those kind of devices are either mission critical, safety critical, and perhaps require extreme security. And as a testament to our focus on safety and security, we recently released QNX version 7, and its three key anchor features were true 64-bit support for ARM and Intel system on chips, refreshing our safety certifications for ISO 26262 ACLD for automotive, IEC 61508 SIL3 for industrial, and IEC 62304 for medical. And along with the safety certifications, the other key anchor feature was greatly enhanced security. We added a wide range of additional security features at the operating system level, such as secure boot, a layered approach, complete chain of trust, integrity management, access control lists, and runtime anomaly detection, and a wide number of other features. And I'd like to hand over to Hans-Peter, who will give you more detail on QNX.
Hello to everyone. Thank you also from my side for joining this webinar today. At Triadem, I'm responsible for the QNX product distribution and for the development of port support packages. With more than 25 years experience in the embedded software field, I do have a good understanding of small, mid and high-end microprocessors with different operating systems. At the beginning, some words about Triadem. We are an engineering company based in Switzerland, providing solutions and technologies for mission-critical applications and embedded systems. We are the official QNX distributor for Switzerland since 2004 and started working together with Toradex in 2005, enabling QNX for their modules. Our service offer includes drivers and BSP development, consulting, training, and also specific application development. The agenda and topics we cover today is split in three parts. First, an overview on QNX and specific enhancements of the QNX software development platform. In the second part, I will show you the development tools with the BSP for the Toradex module. Finally, I will show the graphic demos we put together for the evaluation image and how you can start with your own project or evaluation. And as mentioned, at the end, we have time for questions. I do not know your operating system background and would like to give you first an overview of the QNX SPD from a developer point of view. The development suite is based on Eclipse. QNX was one of the founding members of the Eclipse Foundation back in 2001 and is still today an active contributor on the CDD project for C and C++ support. The toolchain does use the GNU compiler and debugger. QNX is certified POSIX compliant, making it relatively easy to port code from open source or Linux. For embedded Linux developers, it's very straightforward to start with QNX, as it looks and feels like Linux, Unix. With SPD 7, or a software center was added to make it easy to manage and update SPD 7 over the web. Evaluating an embedded OS is a complex and difficult task. You want to make sure the choice you made will last for several years, as porting code from one OS to another can be very expensive. As a result, the OS needs to cover important key features. QNX is a full-featured OS with built-in security and safety by design. The microkernel architecture. Look closer to the microkernel in the next slides. A very good support for graphics and HMI solution like OpenGL ES, HTML5, Crank Storyboard and Qt. And you need good hardware support and the possibility to change from one silicon vendor to another with very little porting effort. The microkernel architecture is very important for the QNX OS and the base for the slogan "Safe by Design." So we take some time to understand the advantage of this architecture. The microkernel has the fewest possible components with CPU kernel privileges, like thread and scheduling services, signal and message passing services, timers, and the process manager dealing with memory and path namespace. All the other components like file system, network stack, drivers, which belong with a monolithic kernel architecture to the kernel, do run with the microkernel in separated memory space with user privileges like a normal application. For example, if a driver fails, this will not result in a crash of the complete system. Only the faulty component terminates and could dynamically be restarted to recover without a reboot. The strict separation is also very helpful, as it can reduce the scope for certification only to the safety relevant components. There are two other big advantages. You can develop and debug drivers like normal applications. and important both components can be started independently to scale and extend your own system as required without running unused services. The OS provides a simple but powerful set of inter-process communication capabilities that simplify the design of an application as a set of cooperating processes in which each process handles a well-defined part. In this example, a media application requests playback of a specific media file. The multimedia stack is a resource manager that presents its POSIX interface to the application. The file system, which runs in its own process, is also a resource manager. The multimedia stack can perform open and read operations and the file to serve the request of the media application. As you may see, these IPC communications add a little CPU overhead compared to a monolithic approach. But with modern powerful CPUs, this small overhead is not important compared to the advantage of separation and system determinism. The following three slides are other general design aspects helping address the goal to provide a safe and secure system. To run QNX, a memory management unit, MMU, to map physical memory to virtual memory is mandatory. A memory protection unit, MPU, like supported by Cortex-M processor, for example, does not support this feature necessary to run QNX. QNX implements read-only guard pages at the end of each virtual stack to protect against stack overflow. QNX does support the standard POSIX scheduling algorithms FIFO, round-robin, and sporadic. In addition, adaptive partitioning is supported. With this technology, you can divide your system into different partitions with a defined minimal CPU time budget containing assigned processes. If, for an unexpected reason, a thread with a high priority level would try to use all CPU time, the scheduler would enforce the time budget, allowing also the lower priority thread to run as expected. As an example, if you include third-party code in your product with adaptive partitioning, you can prevent this code from affecting safe operation in your system. Most OS services are based on a unique resource manager architecture using resource manager framework. The resource managers are server programs with a well-defined API. Applications and resource managers interact in a client-server relationship. Device drivers and the file system are implemented as resource managers. QNX 7.0 was released in March this year. The previous measure version QNX 6 with the latest version 6.6 is still supported. QNX 6 is in the market for more than 15 years. Compatibility between the different versions is very good, but with the transition to QNX 7, some adaptations have to be done. We have new 64-bit support to take full advantage of ARM V8 and Intel CPUs. There are kernel variants for 32 and 64-bit support. For a long time, 32-bit was sufficient for most embedded applications. But with the demand in higher CPU power and memory resources, the 64-bit support is an important step. Safety and security features were the main focus for QNX 7, which we'll look in detail. If you develop products requiring certification, like in medical, transportation, or industrial automation sector, you know how important it is to start at the beginning with the right components and software solution. Even then, the task is a big challenge. As mentioned before, safety is not an afterthought. This is also the case for QNX. The product development process has to meet all the steps required for the certification. For the certification, QNX is working with TÜV Rheinland in Germany. Following certified products will be available. The QNX OS for safety according ISO 26262 for the automotive market and functional safety according IEC 61508 SEAL 3. Release date is planned for December 2017. QNX OS for medical covering IEC 62304 Class C is planned for mid-2018. I think it's important to mention the certified and non-certified products have the same kernel and identical API. There are other offers from competitors naming their certified and non-certified product in a way you may think they are compatible, but the API and the supported functions are very different. Together with the existing security features, lots of new features were added with QNX 7, which I will present with the next slides. With the trend having more and more connected embedded devices and with IoT, security becomes a bigger concern. According a Gartner report, as per 2017, there were 8 billion connected devices, and for 2020, the estimation is about 20 billion devices. But all the security features do not help if not used correctly. The system integrator has to set up and maintain security policies to defend and protect the product. In the QNX documentation, the security developer guide contains best practice examples and refers to the other documentation helping for this task. Processor protection. Address space layout randomization does set up process resources like heap and stack buffers in a way to prevent attacks over memory. This feature is existing as an option in QNX 6 and is enabled by default with QNX 7. POSIX access control. The well-known POSIX file mode permission for read, write, and execute control. Permissions should be set as restrictive as possible. Access control lists. QNX provides full ACL support for the QNX file system. Rootless operation. Root access is divided into more than 50 root level capabilities via process manager abilities. Processes can be limited to exactly the abilities they need. The abilities can be set via policy. As a result, it is possible to design a system where no process required to run with root privileges. In such a system, an attacker who can compromise a process is limited to the assigned abilities and not having root access. Authentication control. The open palm-pluggable authentication model framework is new integrated for authentication and identification support. OpenPAM is also used in macOS, certain Linux distributions, and free BSD. Network security. The QNX network stack supports industry standard security protocols, including TLS, SSL, and IPsec. The secure file system. It's a complete integration of the Certicom 256-bit advanced encryption standard. Certicom is also part of BlackBerry Technical Solutions BTS. The secure file system has to be licensed as an option. The self-verifying file systems ensures the integrity of the file system done at the block level check. Together with a trusted boot chain, this can be very effective to secure a system against local modifications on the disk. Integrity measurements. This is a mechanism to log system activities in order to detect security violations or abnormal behavior in the system. Passphrase control restricts access to a process to a system passphrase by verifying the connect messages and matching the given pass against a list of allowed and forbidden entries. Mandatory access controls. MAC on QNX is used to restrict or allow operations between different processes. Anomaly detection monitors inter-process messages passing in order to detect changes in the given runtime behavior. System designers can decide on the reaction on an anomaly detection. All the presented security features are available to the system designer to build a secure system. I'm afraid this was a little difficult to follow, but the topic is not simple and worth spending enough time to implement into the own system. Another important topic is secure boot with a complete chain of trust. Starting on the hardware CPU level with a verified and trusted bootloader to load a validated QNX OS image. Once the QNX OS is up and running, the file system is validated by the OS to start signed applications. The BSP we did port for the Toradex i.MX module does not support secure boot. If your product requires secure boot, this could be done as an engineering service. Last but not least, the operating system needs a CPU to run and is only useful if your intended hardware selection is supported. This is the actual list of supported hardware already available or still under development. A BSP for the NXP i.MX8 is planned, but I can't give a release date at this time. The actual available BSP can be found on the BlackBerry QNX website. QNX 7 has support for a wide range of popular GPUs from Intermediation, Vivante, NVIDIA, Qualcomm and Intel. This is key to build embedded devices with performant HMI solutions. Here we are at the end on the QNX technology and QNX 7 presentation, and I will start the practical part. Here I'm in the QNX Momentix development tool. The BSP we did develop for the Apelis i.MX6 is based on the QNX BSP for the NXP i.MX6 evaluation board. First, we want to have a look in the BSP structure. We have here the pre-built directory, which contains all the content where we don't have the source to build, for example, like graphic drivers and the USB stack and some drivers. Then we have the source directory. Here we have all the drivers specific for the BSP. For example, here, this is the driver for SD card support, for serial interface, the network driver, and so on. And here, the startup directory is not the driver. This directory does contain the startup code binary. The startup code is the first code executed after U-boot did load the QNX image into memory. The startup initialized the CPU and the periphery and then jumped to the QNX kernel. In the install directory are all the components we did build from the source directory and also the one coming from the pre-built. From here, from the install, the image is built from the inside, from the here in the image. We can see here the built image and the build script. We now go and see in more detail what we have in the build script. At the beginning, as mentioned before with the startup code, here we have this binary, which is called at the beginning. So here at this moment in the time, we are not yet in the kernel. The kernel is just at the end after the startup code called. After this, once the kernel is up and running, it's really only the kernel, the microkernel at this moment. Then we come here at the place in the startup script. I will place my mouse a little bit left because otherwise it's difficult probably for you to see. So at the beginning, some environmental variables are defined. Then we have output of the image which we are booting. We are starting here the real-time clock to have the system right, the system time right. Some common services like a logging device, dumper, and so on. We start the watchdog kick to restart the watchdog to prevent him from resetting the system. So this is done very early at startup. Then the serial interfaces, which we start, the E2C drivers, and so on. Here we have the SD card and eMMC driver, which is started. So you see all this driver with the command to launch them is quite simple. also things I don't want to have in my BSP if I start, I just can comment out. So here we have the USB stack started. Here the network stack with a fixed IP for the demo, and so on. Here the graphical user interface, the graphical component, touch support, and then at the end we give the control to the console. So that's the end of the startup script. Also in the build file, we have all the components we want to include inside our image. So at the beginning, you find here all the libraries we want to include. Then here starts the section where we put the binaries we want to have inside our image, like here the network stack, other utilities we want to have inside our image. And here you see these are files we want to include inside our image to have them on the file system, on the boot file system. Here, this is an example of an inline file, what we want to have in the file is directly inside the build file. And here, this here is an example of a file we include into our image coming from the host PC and just included from the QNX target of the installed version from QNX. And here are the files defining the login, the PAM configuration, and so on. So if I want to build my image, the only thing I have to do is to launch a build target configuration. I now here have to that we see what is going on. I start it and we see that the build process is started and we build the specific image. So it takes some seconds and then the new image is built. So in this example, the image is around, I think, around 90 megabyte big, the image we built here. So, and what you can see, most of the components building the image are not coming from the BSP itself. You see here, this is coming from my installation of QNX. So this is generic, these are generic binaries, same for all BSPs. I now change from the C++ perspective to the system information view. We want to have a look at the running target. I'm connected over the serial interface here, and I can do some comments. So you see, we are on QNX 7 on the target, connected over TCP/IP. And a look into the devices we have. So as mentioned before, this looks very Unix, Linux-like. I now do a reset on my hardware. So maybe just before I clear the terminal so that we only have the boot of it. So at the moment, U-boot is starting. The image is loading from the SD card, and here, it's already done. QNX is up and running. So to have a little look on what is going on here, it's just U-boot until here. Then I put verbosity on the startup code to see the detected hardware. And here at this point, we are really inside the QNX kernel. And these are the lines you did see before in my build file. And with the devices we did start inside. So what is also very nice and handy, I'm connected to the target over TS over the network, and I can see into my target. This is done over this QCon here. This is a monitor enabling the communication between the development environment and the target. I have here a look onto the target and can see all the started processes. I now again show you the devices which are running, and we can see here, for example, the three E2C drivers. I now will terminate one of these, and if I do look in again, I see this driver is no more here. So really, drivers can be started and stopped as said before. Also in the system information view, there are other nice features. Here I see an overview of my target. I see that the four cores running at the CPU speed. I have the memory usage. You can also have a look on process level. We take the serial interface. I see here thread information. The device is running with two threads. I can see here how my driver was started with the arguments given for to start the driver. I can have a look of the map of the memory from from this driver. I can dive, for example, into the stack, and I see here what the guard, for example, the read-only guard in the stack. The memory allocation, which I can use, for example, if I have a memory leak, that's really helpful to debug. Here, with this, the file target navigator, I can have a look into the file system of my target. The binaries I have, also devices which we saw before on the console. So, and here back, I'm on my console again. So now what we want to do is I want to show you a debug session, and we don't take a Hello World application for this. I do use the EMMC driver we have on the module, and here before we start the debugging, I just have to show you how it's working. So the driver is normally started with these arguments, and then we mount the DOS partition into the file system. So if I do a mount here, I see the mount. And here, looking into the file system. just take here also the command how to mount, because if I do the debug, then we will remount again. So now to start my debug session, I first have to terminate the running process. And now, yeah, as expected, there is the file system is no more here. I now go to the debug perspective and I launch my debug session. And here I'm already at the main of the driver. I can do some single steps and yeah, it's like debugging. And I did put a breakpoint at the read-write function so that we hit the breakpoint if I run the driver. So I'm doing it and you see here we are on the breakpoint. I relaunch and once again, and now, yeah, the driver is again up and running. And I would see it if I go here again into the device. Here we see the driver is up and running. If I do now my mount command, again, the driver is hitting because we have an interaction with the file system. So now I take away this breakpoint and yeah, run. So as it sees now, the driver is again, yeah, working. And if I stop again, yeah, my driver, I do it again. See, I'm blocked and I can restart my driver and everything goes again as expected. Now at the end for the demonstration, I just want also to show you a nice feature to do a kernel device, a kernel event trace. For this, I close here. So I run it and now for 3 seconds, all the kernel events are locked and we can have a look at them now. Here I see inside the usage of the activity in the CPU. We see we have a lot of idle activity and some interrupt and kernel use. So we just have to mention that to have some activity in the system, I do have the vector graphic demo, the VG Tiger running. And if we now have a look, example to CPU activity, we see here all the 4 CPUs are used. So that's really a multi-core application. I can show you the CPU the timeline. So here, this is a timeline of all the 3 seconds. And now we have too much processes and I do deselect here because we are only interested in our Tiger and the graphic screen framework. So you can open them. Open Tiger And so now I can also go and see details here. Zoom in. Did I do it? Ah, so I did zoom out. So now zoom in. And I see here now on a really detailed level what is going up on my system when the process is running, when we are ready running, and all the interruptions in with the kernel events. Okay. Now I want to show you the demo we did with the graphical applications. So I had to take a video because the light conditions are not so good. And yeah, it was better to have a video. We built this demo. The launcher application is built with screen, with QNX screen. So, and we can then launch a different applications on this demo. So I start my video. And at the beginning, we will zoom a little bit in to see it better. So the first thing is the OpenGL demo with the gears. This demo is well known, but it's a good test for benchmark and to see if the GPU is good integrated. Here we run with two instances and with a frame rate of 70. Here we start a medical demo from Crank Software, and you could also easily from Crank take other graphical demos and integrate them into the demo and launch them. So it's open the launcher. It's the start is done by scripts, and you could extend easily this application. The home automation demo on a smaller resolution. And here on the right side, there are simple slide viewers. We did implement this application also with screen, so showing some photos of, example here, Toradex. And now with the nice reboot button, we do a reboot, and you see here it was U-boot, then image loading, and it's already up and running. I do it again. So see, that's really going fast and it's really operational. So you can just start a graphical application and you see it's really a few seconds and it could be still done faster. Going back to the presentation. So what to do if you want to evaluate QNX and the BSP for Toradex? At the BlackBerry QNX website, register a MyQNX account. Best is to use a company email address to register. Then you request simply an evaluation license. To start the evaluation with the BSP, first, you would need a module, so you could order it over the web. And best suited would be an Aprilis i.MX6 with Xora carrier board. To get the evaluation image, you can simply send us an email and we will help you. We did technically test with the Toradex Easy Installer, and we plan to make the demo available in the next few weeks. So thank you for your attention, and we are now ready for your questions.
Thank you very much, Hans-Peter. Let's have a look at questions which came in. One question, I'm just quickly going to read it. So how does QNX take advantage of the M4 core on the i.MX 7? I presume QNX is an RTOS for Cortex A7 core, right? So I think that question is probably directly for Hans-Peter. And how can the M4 core be used with together with QNX, or is it used at all, basically?
Well, as mentioned before, it's not possible to run QNX on this M4. But for sure, if you would have bare metal or another operating an operating system on the M4, it's the communication is possible between the QNX on the A and the M4.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. Then, which Toradex modules do have QNX support today? Can you also comment on that, Hans-Peter?
Yeah, for QNX 6.6, we have i.MX 7 and also the i.MX 6 modules on Palis and Colibri. We did now start with QNX 7, and at the moment the QNX 7 is available on the Palis i.MX 6 quad. But the other modules will also follow just in the next time.
Good. And the next question, which licenses are available? Example, royalty, developer seat, and how does the QNX business model look like? I think that's best to be answered by Gary.
Right. So the QNX business model has three main areas. The first part is upfront licensing for development seats. Each developer working on a QNX project needs a QNX development seat. We also have a number of specialist technologies which require a per project license. Examples of that would be the safety certified kernels or the hypervisor. We then have runtime royalties. For each device that our customers manufacture, they pay a runtime royalty. And we feel that this is a very fair way to work, because it means that our customers only start paying us royalties when they start shipping their product. So it means that QNX is very motivated to help our customers get to production. We almost work with you as partners rather than as a supplier. And then the third part of our business model is our services. Just in the same way that Triadem can provide services for customers to develop board support packages for hardware such as Toradex's modules, and QNX has a services team as well that's typically engaged by our customers to do the low-level device driver, board bring-up, the protocol integration type development work.
Okay. Next question. Do demo images exist for hypervisor functionality, and does QNX evaluation license or evaluation include it? Hans-Peter, can you answer that?
The QNX hypervisor, no, that's not included in the demo image. No, that had to be done separately.
Okay, then another one on an AM5072X, I have similar question, A15 and M4. So is there a BSP available for this AM5072X? Hans-Peter, do you know that directly?
Perhaps I could answer that question. The answer is yes, we do have a QNX 6.6 BSP for the TI AM572X.
Okay, then the next question. Who should I contact in case of QNX questions on a Toradex module? I will just directly answer that. You can directly talk to Triadem, as they have best knowledge, of course. They will for sure be able to help. If it's a hardware-related issue, then of course we will work together with Triadem to get that resolved directly. So, but anyway, main contact with questions on QNX on Toradex modules will be Triadem. Then the next question, okay, which graphical framework do you recommend on top of QNX? Well, you quickly mentioned something during your presentation with Hans-Peter. Can you add some more points here?
Yeah, so the QNX screen framework is really very open to different third-party products, and it's really up to the customer what he want to use with. So we have specifically good experience with Qt and Crank software system, but yeah, it's really open and depends also what kind of application you want to do.
Okay. The next question, again, about the TI-AM572X. So we said that the BSP is available, but the question is it also the QNX 7.0, Gary?
Yes, it is.
Okay. Then one more question here. What's the situation regarding drivers for peripherals such as Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, touch controllers, etc.? Are they usually available like in Linux? If not, how do I get such peripherals integrated? Hans-Peter, can you comment on that?
Yeah, depending on the hardware you want to use, but some drivers are available, but it's not like with Linux that all the suppliers also have a QNX driver. So if you want to use something, you have to look directly with QNX or with another service company to help integrate like a Wi-Fi driver. And also from QNX, there is support and they have a Bluetooth framework so that you can use. And also for Wi-Fi, there is good support. But yeah, best is you would directly contact QNX.
Okay, and next question. When do you recommend using QNX instead of other operating systems such as embedded Linux? Hans-Peter, probably also something you can easily answer.
Yeah, I think if you did watch the webinar, so there are really, if you have something to do with safety and security, I think it's really a big advantage to use QNX instead of Linux. And also, if you have real-time concerns, QNX is really very good to use. And I think it's also very simple to maintain. And so for a lot of applications, QNX is a really good fit. But for also general use, I think Linux is very a good choice as well.
All right. Next question here. Why should I use a Toradex product with QNX? I think I can comment on that. Yeah, so Toradex, we're really focusing on bringing reliable and easy to use products to customers for embedded and industrial use. And this is basically also quite similar to QNX, of course. I mean, it's really, QNX is really a lot about reliability, safety, security. And of course, also, as you saw in the webinar, it's actually quite easy to use and directly focus on your application. So you're not gonna, you don't have to think about the hardware or the operating system. You can really focus on your application and really make sure that you add your value, your unique value, and you don't need to worry about, the basics. In some terms, of course, it's not that easy, but basics like the hardware or then the operating system. So therefore, I think QNX and Toradex is a really good match. Okay, let me see if there are any other questions. No, it looks like we're through. Okay, no further questions. So, then I think we can conclude this webinar. I really hope you enjoyed the webinar brought to you by Toradex and our partners, BlackBerry, QNX, and Triadem. In particular, I would like to thank Hans, Peter, and Gary for their presentations. As mentioned initially, the webinar has been recorded and we will make it publicly available on our website in about 1 week from now. So thank you, everybody, and have a great day. Bye.